You know, for thousands of years, the ability of a community to survive depended on the ability of its members to communicate to succeeding generations the traditional values, attitudes, and skills that make that community, or those communities, cohesive unit. We're here today at the Skellinger House on Main Street in Amagansett. We're with two members of East Hampton's fishing community who have witnessed throughout their lives the growth and development and strength of East Hampton's fishing community. We're here with Bill Lester and Jarvis Wood, and they're men who have been fishermen and have been part of the fishing community for quite a few years. Bill, can you tell us a little bit about your family and when you were born and where?
Well, I was born in 1900, and we had 11 children in the family, and we had, I don't know how to say it, my father was sick good when a young man, and my oldest brothers, Frank and Harry, they took over, took care of the children. And then when they got married, Charles, my brother Charles and I, we took over. And then they all got married and got out. And
what kind of work did your father do?
He always fished. He always had, years ago, he hired two men to help him fishing. And them days, most of the time, they had a shanty on the beach right here where the bathhouse is. And it's all he ever done was fishing, my father. So all I ever done. And I always loved it. And I'd like to do it now, but I'm getting a little bit too old for it. The last fishing I'd done was about 11 years ago. I used to go down with a boy and see what they were doing, helping them a little bit. But then I got to, so I figured I was more in the way than I was doing good, so I quit. I had a good life. I had two beautiful wives.
At the same time?
Not at the same time, no way, no way. And I got a beautiful wife now and somebody to take care of me. She's 24 years younger than I am, and she takes real good care of me. And so I've had a good life. I've had some bad luck, and I've had a lot of good luck and a lot of bad luck. And I lost a girl, my first wife. The girl was 16, and she was in the hospital, and she died of leukemia. And I was there when she passed away, so it was a very sorry bed. And then my second wife, I had a boy named Kenny, and he got killed in a car accident on a Sacramento turnpike on that sharp turn there. He was 16. So I don't know what else to say.
Jarvis, can you tell us where you were born and when?
Well, I was born in Springs, 1908, January 5th, a few days ago, I celebrated my 80th birthday. We had a nice party. And when we was about 5-6 years old, my father was a fisherman, and he used to go down to Montauk, down in where the light in Cub Tuttle's Bend, they used to call it, and he used to go down there in the summertime, and we lived in a little shanty down there, and he went fishing from there. We went out on the ocean, you know, straight after bluefish and fluke and whatever he could get on hand line. Then in the winter, and when the fall, we'd move back to Lazy Point. We lived in Lazy Point. Lazy Point, up there, you could make a living clamming, and you know, all winter, scalloping and so on. So that's how we got along, but we didn't have too much. We always had plenty to eat, and we kept warm, and that was it. Them days, you didn't require very much. We never had no lights, and no doors, so everything was, went along fairly good. And as we got older, we moved up to Springs, and I went to school Springs. I was 9 years old, you know, over Springs, moved up Springs, and we had 11 children, all of us. I mean, our family was 11 children. And there's three of them passed away, the rest are still alive.
So, what was it like being part of, Bill, you were part of a large family too, right?
Yeah. We're 11 in our family.
Yeah. What was it like being one of 11 children?
Well, I was the oldest one, and I was like Bill. I had to go to work, I had to quit school when I was 16, and went to work to help take care of the family. Because at that time, there was quite a big family to take care of. When I was 16, there was a lot of children, all young children. My father wasn't able to do too much, but we always had plenty to eat and so on. So I helped take care of the family until I was about 19, 20 years old, before I got married.
When you were both growing up, what was it like sitting around the family table with all these kids and your parents around?
Well,
was it crowded?
Well, yeah, sometimes.
we was always crowded. Let me see, 1, 2, 3. We had 4 small rooms downstairs and 2 rooms upstairs. And well, 11 of us had to bunk in, you know, in a small house, but we was young, and we didn't mind it because never knew any different. So we had it very good. We was always a pretty poor family.
But did you know you were poor?
No, I don't think we realized we were poor. I'll tell you, when it went to we used to live up the road here about a quarter of a mile ago, and we used to walk to East Hampton School, 2.5 miles from the old homestead, and of course sometimes in the morning we'd go up to my grandmother's and she'd give us something for breakfast, and then at noon we'd always go there and have dinner. And she always had something to eat for us. And when we got through dinner, she always had a piece of some kind of pie. Wasn't a very big piece, but we appreciated it very much, and I never forgot her. Her picture is right up in there, that second in the middle. And beautiful woman. The reason why we thought she was so beautiful, I suppose she took care of us. And I think about a whole lot. So if she didn't go to heaven, she should have went there.
Jarvis, do you remember your grandparents? Were you around them very much?
Yeah, my grandmother. She was living next door to us, and our little village was near a quarter mile away. And she used to take in washing iron to take care of the family, her family. And she was a hard-working woman, and she took in washing iron. I remember she used to have a big boiler that she put on the stove and heat it up and put the clothes in, boil them up, take them out and rinse them and put them on the line. And I helped her many a day pound the pound barrel, the pounder, tied up and down to wash the clothes. There was no, all the things was done by hand. There was no machines in them days. And pump the water from the pump, get the water to wash with, and all that. That was a lot of work. Mm-hmm. But she was a hard-working woman, but she always had plenty to eat. We used to go there. We had always, same as Bill said, always had pie or something to eat. And every Sunday she had a big pile of samp on the stove, and we'd go into that sometimes and have a dish of salmon for Sunday dinner, homemade bread. Always plenty to eat.
Them days, salmon was a must.
That's right.
Saturday and Sunday from school, I'd say it. And another thing, it was quite interesting. Of course, Sunday, them days, we weren't allowed to play in the streets. We had to go in the backyard. Mm-hmm. And our pleasure was Saturday and Sunday. It was our pleasure them days when we was little fellas, was taking the old dog, going in the woods, and in these old stumps, we'd always see if there's some kind of an animal in there. And the old dog was with us, and if he was scratching and growling and barking, kind of, you know, we'd know there was something in there. So we'd cut these possums out, took a hatchet or an axe. And of course, them days we got 25 cents of the bounty on foxes and possums and coons. 25 cent bounty on a possum, and then we sold a carcass of the possum to three or four families in town that they ate the possums. We got 25 cents for the possum, and we got 25 cents for bounty, so 50 cents, that was quite a lot of money them days.
The ears was worth it.
That was our hobby job.
Yeah,
that was our hobby.
Well, yeah, that's practically all we caught. Down on the thing, sometimes we used to get after a fox. Sometimes you get a fox in a burrow on a hill, and we'd dig into him and try to catch him, but we didn't have very good luck at that. they were pretty foxy. You have to shoot them, you know, with a gun.
Well, we caught a lot of different stuff. We used to get quail. Them days, we had a quail here that was, our quail was bigger than the southern quail, so they brought some of them southern quail up here and mixed them in with ours, and then we got a smaller bird. But we were selling these quail to the markets, 75 cents a piece. Well, that was a lot of money. And then the last of it, we'd get a dollar and a quarter for them. And of course, we done something we wasn't supposed to do too, you know. We used to set snares for quail, put out two stakes, and put a string across, and did a long tail out of a horse, and make loops, and put wheat along the line, and the quail, because I was 8 or 10 to once in these snares. First it go through these loops, it fits up around the neck, and we had them. And we weren't supposed to do it. It was always the law against it. But, you know, we did do them things once in a while.
Sure, once in a while.
we used to do a lot of gunning for black duck, coots, sheldrake. And that was a big part of our, in the wintertime, when the thing would froze up, a lot of snow, and that was a big part of our living, was the ducks. Father used to go out and get ducks, and we'd have ducks to cook. Mm-hmm. And mother used to take them. Take all the flat feathers off and singe them, and she was taking, put them in a little pan of warm water, and take some Miss Brown octagon soap. I used to buy, you can't buy it now, but she'd take out the warm water, she'd take all that and go on that skin of that duck, and she'd clean it all off with that soap and make a nice lather onto it. And then after you got that done, she'd throw the water away and get new warm water and wash the soap off of the duck. And then she'd cook the duck, and you wouldn't no fish taste. All that fish taste in the duck was gone.
Mm-hmm.
It was really, really good eating then.
Mm-hmm.
So nowadays people don't think though that doing those things they take whatever they can get. But there was a lot of hard times in the winter time when everything could froze up and they couldn't work.
Was it hard? Was it cold?
Yeah, it was cold. We used to go along the shore, pick up the wood to burn, and have to cut it, bring it in the house, put it in the stove, of course, keep warm. And in that time, when you went to bed, the fire went out, well, next morning it wasn't very warm. But we didn't know any difference. We were happy.
Mm-hmm.
We used to have parties, people get together and have parties, have dances, and dance, and have a good time, had a lot of fun too. I mean, when I was a kid, I was maybe about 16, He used to catch, used to take and go down in a creek, Bonnet Creek there, and when it froze over, and they'd come down in with the teams and take and fill the ice house up for the men to head fishing ship year round, and fill their ice house full of ice for the summer. Take put that ice in it, you take a lot of salt hay and put in the bottom, and then put in your ice in there and the salt hay and keep building your ice house full. And that would keep all summer, that ice. And they'd take store it off in big chunks, you know, whatever you could handle, 100 pound, maybe 75 pound, and take it on pitchforks and shovels or any way you could handle it. Sometimes you had hooks, slide it in, and there. But it was a cold job them days. Them horses would be waiting, you know, take the cart on the wagons, take the horse back and forth, and horses would be snoring, and the icicles would be hanging off of the chin from the breath, you know. Mm-hmm. It was cold weather them days. That's when you had to get the ice, of course. So it was good. I used to watch them. I didn't do very much of it, because I used to watch them doing, you know, on the shore, watch them.
When did your families first come to East Hampton, do you know?
What was that?
When did your families first come to East Hampton? Any idea?
Oh, the fellas. The fellas come in here. Oh, jeez. I suppose it's over 200 years ago. There was a schooner come in here, just right down west of us here. They come in here, I think, on her. And some of them stayed here. Joe Cousins and Mason Neistam, I forget their name. They stayed here and married. There was half a dozen of that ship stayed in here and married here. And the rest of them went to New York. And of course, she came out long before my day, but I remember her well. And half a dozen of them stayed here anyway and got married and stayed here. And I guess most of them gone now.
Mm-hmm. Jarvis, when did your family get here? Have they been around a while?
My father came from here from Patch York. I guess before he was married, he lived in Patchogue. Then he come down here, because my mother was born here in spring.
When did your mother's family first get here, do you know?
I was about 1900, probably. Mm-hmm. But my grandfather, my grandmother, they lived here I don't know how long it was here, but they were natives of Springs, even, you know, for long ago as we can remember.
So your family going back has been here for quite a few generations?
Yeah.
You know, I don't like to brag, but when I was fishing younger, there's a lot of people used to come to me for information. And I know one fellow particular down here, named Toby Griffin. And he says, how do you catch so many fish? Well, I says, hard work, keep it going. Well, they went down to the ocean this morning. We all made a draw or two, never got nothing. So I went home. So he remembered what I told him, so he kept working. Well, he come home that afternoon, wherever it was, and he had a load of bass. When he come up to me and he says, I thought you said you had to keep it going if you want to catch some. I never forget them things, you know. So he kept me going. He brought home a little load of them.
When you two were growing up, when you were little, did you get a chance to go around much with your fathers or with neighbors when they were fishing? How did you learn how to become?
Well, we was there. We was with my father most of the time on the beach.
Sure.
And of course, we used to pick up. My first fishing was frost fishing in the winter, wading, what you call them. And we used to, if in the winter there was snow on the ground, we'd put this box of fish on a sled we had. We called them an ice cutter then. And we'd take them to the railroad station, ship them to New York. That's the first my fishing, if you call it fishing.
How old were you?
About eight or nine. I remember one day, it's quite interesting. We had one lantern. We went down this night, you know, and Charles, my brother, his picture's there, and he took a lantern and went east. So I went west. Took a bag, Vicky whitened up as fast as they come up on the flat and got chilled, you know. And I was going along, we just pick up a codfish once in a while. And I see this, I thought it was a big codfish, you know. So kind of, I read down, going to pick him up, and it was a seal jumped up. You know, it's dark, you know, and kind of scared me, though. I never forgot it. I thought I was going to pick up a codfish, and it was a seal. He scampered out of there, and I scampered out, too.
Jarvis, how about you? Did you get a chance to spend much time with your father when you were a little kid?
Yeah, we was always together. I mean, I was fishing with him wherever was possible. We used to, he doesn't want to fish, and I just help him a little bit. But I enjoyed it. I learned how, learned a lot, of course.
You've done a lot of it, John.
Oh, yeah. At the time, I didn't think I was doing very much, but probably was a help. But we had to row a boat. We didn't have no motors. We had to row a boat. And I would go and help him row the boat, see, to get where we wanted to go. We'd take 2 barrel oars in the boat, one in the back and the front, and we'd row the boat. And it was quite a help. Even a little bit was another big help in days. So then we had to ship our fish and sell them wherever we could, you know. There was no market like it is today. And you had to have a train down here on the station. We have to take all of our fish up to the station, put them on the railroad train, ship to New York, with a horse and wagon, come up with a horse and wagon.
What's the biggest catch of fish you caught, Bill?
We got 377 boxes of bass we saved to Heather Plain. And we busted open on the east side, close to the bunt. And quite a lot of them went out, but we saved 377 or somewhere around there, boxes. That was 150-pound boxes them days. And my brother Ted, the ones that got out of us, he sat around us and he got a 100 boxes that got out of us, 150-pound boxes. So how that happened, Elisha Ramon was going by, he had a dragger, he was out there going by, I don't know, quite a ways off. He had a quarter of a mile, maybe better. And this fish, bunch of fish come up behind him. So we sat right around him. And we saved 377, I think it was, boxes. Brother got 100 boxes out of them.
Jarvis, how about you? What, can you think of an exciting catch you made or exciting day?
Well, we used to catch blowfish and have to skin them. And see, that's a blowfish, that's a bottle fish we used to call them in the days. Now they call them blowfish. Well, we used to catch all those. There's no end to them. You had a trap out there and they just fill right up. Fish, you take them out. So we could skin and get rid of. So we made good money on the bottle fish.
Mm-hmm. Well, them days, 7 or 8 cents a lot of money, wasn't it?
Yes. We made 10 cents on a pound. We were doing good. Mm-hmm. That was big money.
What about while you were fishing? You ever have any bad weather?
Russ Lester and I, we was cod fishing, and we set, I think we had 5 trawls that day, 450 hooks on the trawl. I think it was that. And the wind was west. And we went out to haul the gear, and there was a lot of codfish. And it blowed up here west, it blowed wicked, it was awful. And I says to him 2 or 3 times, I says, cut that gear off, I said, let's go in. And he caught a lot of fish, he kept going. And finally he tied the buoy on, we left. What gear we didn't get, we left there, and we started in. Well, the seas got so big, we had Jersey skiffs some days, and they were pretty good. Good sea boats, you know, very good. But these seas got so big that we only had about a 6-horsepower motor, 2-cylinder. And it blows so hard, and so much sea, we never had power enough to get a bow up into the wind so I could ride them seas when I see them coming. So it was the best we could do. We slowed her down and turned her right with the sea. Because when she got done running on the sea would pile up over the stern. So we come there going for it twice. We just happened to, there wasn't another bad sea just that minute, so it saved us. So we pumped the water out, and finally we got in to about a couple of miles from a beach. Of course, it was better weather when I got in there. And Forrest Hulse was out there. He had a dory, good-sized dory. And he went ashore in there big. He was in just in close in, wasn't half as bad weather. But he went in there big, but he washed his engine block cover off one thing or another. And there we was out there 5 or 6 miles in all that big sea. And we was, I think about it quite often, how lucky the Lord must have been with us to save us. We got in. And I think about it quite often. What a chance we shouldn't have been here, but we made it. How, I don't know.
You took an awful chance, but you had help. The Lord to help you.
Somebody with us, I think about it quite often. And it kind of bothers you to think we'd hang on so long or go there that wind.
Well, you had faith in the Lord that He would help you, and you went out there because you really had to go for something to eat. That was your main purpose. You went out there for pleasure.
When we turned that boat to the leeward, them seas, when she slowed down after you get done running, she slowed down, then the sea would pile in. And we stopped pumping, of course, you know. Well, I don't know what saved us yet. I don't know. We shouldn't be here. We should have been out there yet.
Yeah. What about big storms? Can you remember the hurricane of 38? Was that the biggest storm you can remember?
Yeah.
Well, God, I could tell you stories.
A lot of stories can tell.
What was it like in Springs during the hurricane? Were you down in Springs then?
Yeah, I was in Springs.
Can you remember that day?
Yes, I went to... Got all the children in school, got loaded in my car, the children took them home. That's when they first started. And I got, when I on the way home, the children were looking out the car in the back window, and I said, well, I go the trees down. We was just going just under the trees, just and we just got home. Then it started all rain hard, and the water started to come up. And so I went down to help a fella get his car out, and we couldn't get the car out because the water was coming so fast, you know, because we had to leave it there. And all the trees were down, so it was everything was all upset. And I was looking out the window, my kitchen window, and I was on a little hill, and down below me there was a man who had a garage there, and he used to live there. And then the wind picked that garage up, and picked it up like that, and took it over and on another man's car, and set it on top of his car.
Is he taking all this down?
Yeah. Yeah, we sat there, sitting in the window watching him. We were very lucky. Nothing happened to us, nothing happened to us. We were very, everybody was lucky on that early hurricane, because a lot of people could have been killed. But there wasn't very many.
Don't know if anybody killed, was it?
A couple, that's all.
All right, can you tell me what kind of photographs are up on the walls here?
These are photographs which donated from people who took years back. And they found them, and they got them together and gave them to Adelaide, and she fixed them all up nice and made a nice display of them.
Maybe we can walk around a little bit and you can point out some of the albums, some of the photographs from your own families and people that you remember, okay?
Yeah.
Can we try that?
Yeah, why not? I'd give a chance to stretch these bones out.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about this photograph here with the family? Is that the Lester family and a
clan? I suppose a third of them is the Lester family, maybe. Mm-hmm. That's me. That's me standing right there. That was when I was a little slim and a little younger and a little better.
That's you with the cap on.
That's right.
Yeah. Were family gatherings common?
We had them probably a couple of times a year.
Every 4th of July.
In the summer, and 4th of July special.
4th of July was a big day.
This is to Springy Banks. You probably know where it is. Sure. Harbor. There used to be a spring run down there, and all our... melons and anything you wanted to keep cool, We put them in that spring. Mm-hmm. And you'd be surprised how cold that water was coming that spring.
That spring, yeah.
You can't hardly believe it. You know, it'd be nutty and that water would be quite cold.
Mm-hmm. Jarvis, you mentioned 4th of July's. Were they big events for the family to get together or just the whole community?
Well, that was mostly family, you know, families and all the neighbors. They'd all get together on 4th of July and celebrate 4th of July. So that was a big day. We had firecrackers and everything them days, and have a big clam bake, plenty to eat, plenty to drink. Everybody had a good time.
Mm-hmm. What's happened to East Hampton? Has it changed a great deal since you were youngsters?
Well, everything's changed to me.
It's been a big change around here.
Yeah. Everything's reversed. I'll give you a little example now. I bought 1918 town land. I bought 10 acres of woodland. I think it was 1918. And we bought it for the wood. And we burnt, we cut most all of it off and used it in 4 or 5 winters. And now they'll give you the wood. The land's worth something. Them days, if you never had no wood on it, you couldn't get 5 cents an acre for this land. No way. Yeah. But if you had wood on it, you got $15-$20 an acre because they used the wood, see? Mm-hmm. Everything is, if you look back most of the stuff, it's, I think everything is reversed.
What about your great-great-grandchildren or generations to come? What are they going to miss here in East Hampton? What do you think they're going to miss?
They're going to miss farming and fishing.
They're going to miss, that's right.
That's everything going out.
The farming's out, the farming's gone.
They took all the...
And the fishing's almost gone.
Well, is that terrible, do you think? Are they going to be losing something valuable by not
coming? We're old, we think it's wicked. Young people coming on think it's all right, don't know the difference.
That's what we think, because we lived in this generation when we worked for ourselves and we had to see all this going on. But now, this place has come into a tourist colony. Mm-hmm. And everybody is catering to the tourist. And there's no more fishing and no more farming. Everything is commercial. And tourism is taking it all over.
Yeah. What do you think the kids in the future are going to be missing? What lessons in life will they not get by not having the chance to work hard and farm and fish?
No. They're missing a whole lot in their life, because when you go to work, as a young man or a woman, you go to work, you exercise your whole body, you work. And when these people come up now, these children, they don't work too hard because don't have to. They got all the cars and everything to do working for them. I mean, those people are going to miss out the help that they should have and the exercise they should have to extend their lives, because they're liable to have their heart and their lungs will not be strong enough to offset the evil disease that sits in.
Sure.
That's why my idea. I think if you have a good, healthy, strong, and active life, you'll live longer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What do you have any advice for people on how to maintain a quality of life? I mean, you've had a good quality of life here. What would you like to see happen in East Hampton?
I'd like to see stuff roll back somewhere so as a man could get $10 or $12 a day and still stay here. This year, $35 or $40 an hour, some of these people are getting, it's outrageous. And how far is this thing going to go? How far can it go? I heard him say some time ago that the bread, they're going to see the dollar low. Well, the damn thing's going up over a dollar.
Mm-hmm.
It's never going to roll back, is it?
Well, hard to say.
Jarvis, anything what would you like to see happen?
I don't know
what. I'd like to see things as they are not get any worse than any. Progress not to increase anymore, because Long Island, I think, is getting to its point where there's people enough on Long Island, and we're in danger of losing our water, our drinking water, and a lot of other things. I think we should have a little halt to this expansion, this is going on. How it's going to be done, I don't know that it can be done, mm-hmm. but it may not. But I think it's a very sad situation if we keep on going as we have gone for the last 10 years.
Mm-hmm. Do you have anyone in your family who's fishing now, either one of you?
My son's fishing, Calvin over here. Calvin's. Fits on a corner there. Yeah, he's still fishing. He took over where I left off.
Will his son fish, do you think?
Well, it looks so. I hope not, because I think fish is going out. But that's what they probably like, and maybe they'll make out. Couldn't leave Bonnock, you know. It's had a good life here.
All right, well, thank you very much. I appreciate all your
help. Well, I hope this, I hope somebody sees it and likes it, anyways. Maybe they will, years to come, huh?
They might.
No question about it.
You think so, huh? I'm glad to hear you say it.
No question.
Because we're kind of old, and we don't take things like you young people do.
Too much progress. Thank you. May we take this time to give thanks to our Lord and Savior, who gave us all life and breath, for giving us such a wonderful and servant as Adelaide de Mills, who has made this possible to have this historical society in the Skellinger House to show pictures of the past and of the present for all the benefit of the town of East Hampton. People, which I think is very nice of her to do. I think it's a very wonderful exhibit she had provided for the whole society. Thank you.